بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Our case today is very interesting and actually it's a surgical case. Let's will see this case. This case actually is preterm, 28 weeks, gestation infant has been born, and relatively he's in little ventilatory support. And on day 3, feeding started, and started gradually. On day 5, the baby start to have severe abdominal distension. As you see here, severe abdominal distension. This 28 weeks gestation infant has been born and has needed relatively little ventilatory support, and feeds are introduced on day 3 and increasingly gradually. On day 5, he deteriorates and there is obvious abdominal distension, and this is a X-ray. What your impression? So this baby preterm required ventilatory support, started feed on day 3 and the gradual increase. On day 5, there is abdominal distension. Here, this is the X-ray. This is the lateral X-ray. What does X-ray show? You have to describe what you see in this X-ray. Second issues, what do you think what happened for this baby? Is preterm, started feed, and there is abdominal distension. So you have to think about necrotizing enterocolitis. And if you see here, this is air under the diaphragm or above the liver, you have to think this is perforation or pneumoperitoneum or intestinal perforation. What will you do next depend on the condition of the patient. In here, in this X-ray, you see this is lateral X-ray and there is free air under the diaphragm. You see free air under the diaphragm. Hyperlucence area or air under the diaphragm or above the liver. Any free gas air under the diaphragm or above the liver indicate pneumoperitoneum, indicate intestinal perforation. This is surgical emergency. You have immediately to notify the surgeon to intervention or surgical intervention depend on the condition of this baby. Shall the patient is stable or unstable? Unstable patient will both bruise or drain. A stable patient can go for laparotomy. So this is pneumoperitoneum. If you'll see here, this is AB. The previous one was lateral X-ray and was free air above the liver and under the diaphragm. So here, this is the AB. Actually, this is, we call it football sign. This is football. If you see the arrows, you see the arrows here. This is the free air actually in the peritoneum, all over the peritoneum. Gives picture of American football sign. American football sign. So this is the American football sign, and this is clear, very clear. If you see here, this is American football sign. You see the air, hyperlucent air, actually is take all the peritoneal cavity, all the peritoneal cavity. And you see here, this is air under the diaphragm. Sometime only we'll see the air under the diaphragm or above the liver, either to say air under the diaphragm or above the liver. So this is X-ray. There is free gas above the liver in the lateral X-ray and indicate gastrointestinal perforations, and this patient need immediately surgical referral for surgical intervention. What the surgeon are going to do depend on the patient clinical condition. If stable, will go for laparotomy. If the patient unstable or less than 1 kilo, it's who can send, who can do for him drain or bruise drain for evacuation of the air. So this is the risk factor. Our case, what is the risk factor in our case here? In this case, premature, it was premature baby, 28 weeks. This is one of the risk factor, and this is the most important risk factor for intestinal perforation or necrotizing enterocolitis. The prematurity, then prematurity. What is the next risk factor? We start feed, the feeding. Feeding start, especially if non milk formula is not milk, human milk feeding, it will come at risk with bottle formula. The third issue is if there is any other risk factor for this baby. It was ventilated for respiratory support. The ventilation per se and resuscitation per se, it's actually, this is one of the risk factor. risk factor. Also, if there is polycythemia or asphyxia or BDA or the umbilical catheter is there, also it increases the risk factor. Or the mother having medication, if she takes medication like cocaine, it's more risk for perforation. So our risk factor, this patient premature 28, and this is the most important risk factor. Why the premature babies is high risk for necrotizing enterocolitis or perforation? Because immature gut. Second, abnormal vasculature regulation of the gut. Actually, it will has decreased motility, gut motility. These babies have decreased gut motility and abnormal vascular regulation. Abnormal, the premature babies having immature gut, immature vascular regulation, immature gastric motility. Also, the barrier, the function of the gut itself, it has defect like intestinal barrier function. It's defect, have the barrier of the gut is defected. So why the premature baby is high risk for neck or perforation? Immature gut, immature motility, immature vascular regulations, and even the gut function, actually it's intestinal or defect or decrease in intestinal barrier function. So shortly, why the premature baby is a high risk for necrotizing enterocolitis? Due to intestinal structure abnormality, intestinal function abnormalities. Another risk factor, the enteral feeds, aggressive and the advancing of the feed, especially buteal feed, it's high risk for necrotizing enterocolitis and perforation. Another issues, if you are not using the human milk or the human milk feeding, also this is a risk factor. The last risk factor, intestinal ischemia. If there is ischemia, it will come from asphyxia, BDA, because stealing phenomena and decreased blood supply to the gut, polycythemia, and umbilical venous catheter, which will impair with gut perfusion and lead to ischemic gut. And ischemic gut, the bacteria, it will enhance it and lead to necrotizing enterocolitis and lead to intestinal perforation. Mother is receiving cocaine, it will be 2.5 times increased risk for gut perforations and necrotizing anterior colitis. What is the pathophysiology? If you see here, this is, we started with enteral feed. You see, enteral feed. We started because our patient here was 28 weeks, gestation infant, born, and has relatively on respiratory support. And day three started the feed and advancing the feed after third day. And day five start to be abdominal distension. So that the one of the risk factor, the premature, and the second risk factor here, the enteral feed, started the enteral feed. What is the problem with enteral feed? The bacterial perforation, Another risk factor, ischemic gut. You see the ischemic, from where will ischemic gut? From polycythemia, perinatal asphyxia, BDA, umbilical catheter, all this lead to ischemic gut, toxic mucosal damage, lead to loss of the mucosal integrity, integrity of the gut and the epithelial covering and all of this, it will be affected. It will lead to invasion of the mucosa and submucosa, lead to intramural gas, it will come in and just transmural necrosis, perforation, and lead to bacterial pneumonitis or peritonitis. This is the pathophysiology, how it is the perforation happen, how the peritonitis happen, how the gas is come to the intestine. Enteral feed, bacterial perforation, ischemic gut, immature or loss mucosal gut integrity, invasion of the mucosa and submucosa, intramural gas, and lead to perforation. This is the laboratory evaluation already. This is, we know the risk factor and the pathophysiology and the laboratory evaluation for this patient. This is triad, call it HAT. HAT triad, القبعة. HAT. H, hyponatremia. If you do blood gas, there is metabolic acidosis and thrombocytopenia. You have to do septic workup for this patient and septic and general profile or and blood gas to assist this patient and one of the systemic manifestation. Because actually the necrotizing enterocolitis, it will be clinical manifestation and laboratory manifestation and radiological manifestation. Clinical manifestation, GI symptoms like abdominal distension, gastric aspirate, and constipations, cancers and all of this, and also systemic manifestation or laboratory manifestation, it will be hyponatremia, metabolic acidosis, thrombocytopenia, then radiological manifestation. This is the radiological assessment of this patient. Actually, any patient who is having necrotizing enterocolitis should take an AP and the lateral view should be done every 8 hours in the first 2 days if there is necrotizing enterocolitis. Still no perforation because there is bending for perforation. So you have to monitor this patient 12 hourly or 8 hourly clinically, biochemically and radiologically, because it's high risk for perforation, to notify the surgeon immediately for surgical intervention. And this is the radiological finding. Initially, first one, it will be actually abnormal gas pattern. You see abnormal gas pattern. How is this abnormal? Non-specific radiological finding, like dilated bowels and sick bowels, abnormal gas distribution, indicate this is ileus. We call it paralytic ileus, septic ileus. If the potassium is low, it's called paralytic ileus. If the baby is septic, it's called septic ileus. If in general, it will be ileus. This is the abnormal gas pattern. You can label this is septic ileus, paralytic ileus, or whatever. So the second issues, it will be pneumatosis intestinalis, intermural gas. And this is the pathogenic factor or the hallmark of the neck regarding pneumatosis intestinalis. This is bubbles of the gas in the small intestine, and it's seen most in the patient with stage 2 and stage 3. This it will be, you can label this patient, this is stage 2, if there is intramural gas or pneumatosis intestinalis. Then it will go for pneumoperitoneum. You see, pneumoperitoneum, it will be typically bowel perforation occur in patient in stage 3, and substantially amount of intraperitoneal air may result in football sign, called American football sign, and during the supine, it will be actually it will be clear in the supine X-ray and sign consistent with large hypolucent area in the central of the abdomen with marked form of actually is marks from the falciform ligament. It will be falciform ligament. We'll see in the X-ray will be more actually clear for you, and you can see this hypolucent area in the central of the abdomen with marking from actually a falciform ligament. There is, we call it sentinel loops, it's called fixed loop. If you do the X-ray, if you see what you do today and after a while and next day, and you see this is fixed loops, indicate, suggest necrotizing bowel and pre-perforation sign, and indicate even in absence of pneumatosis intestinalis, but fixed bowel and stagnant bowel, actually you can see it in for 1 day or 2 day, indicate this is pre-perforation stage. This is ischemic bowel, ischemic gut, actually is high risk for perforation. You see here, this is the you see here, this is hypolucent areas. You see hypolucent, this is the arrows, hypolucent areas. You see hypo or radiolucent appearance or shadow. You see here, it's take all the peritoneal cavity, it take all the peritoneal cavity here in the center of the abdomen, large hypolucent shadow, take the peritoneal cavity in the peritoneal cavity in the center of the abdomen. And if you see here, this is the center, you see this is the falciform ligament, this is the falciform ligament. You see falciform ligament. Once you see this falciform ligament and this whitish area, straight whitish line in the middle of the abdomen, on the middle of the perforation, this indicates perforation, intestinal perforation. This is called falciform ligament. If you can see the falciform ligament, this indicates this is air, and it will be whitish. You see, it will be whitish. Here, this is surgical emergency. This is pneumoperitoneum in the premature infant. Surgical emergency, and usually indicate the intestinal perforation. Intestinal perforations. So common cause of pneumoperitoneum, actually it will be common in the premature babies. Almost 82 pneumoperitoneum developed from perforation hole viscous in 85 to 95% of the cases. Common cause of pneumoperitoneum is premature babies with necrotizing enterocolitis. Can be other causes of pneumoperitoneum? Yes, isolated gastric or duodenal, colonic or rectal perforation. Here, what is the pneumoperitoneum can be also one of the complications of the patient in required cardiopulmonary resuscitation, or the patient require mechanical ventilation, and also if the patient having previous surgery before is more liable for perforation also, and if the patient having infection with Clostridium perfringensis. Here, what is your management plan for this patient? We said management depend on the severity of the illness, depend on the clinical condition of the patient. Patient is stable or unstable, is hemodynamically stable or unstable, he's in mechanical ventilation and deteriorating the mechanical ventilations, so or of the abdominal distension compromise the respiration, so this patient have to both drain or Benroos drain for unstable patient or the baby preterm less than 1 kilo, so this patient you can both Benroos drain. If the patient is stable, you can sent for laparotomy. So this is Bell stage criteria. What is Bell stage criteria? What is modified Bell stage criteria? This is actually staging of the necrotizing enterocolitis. It is stage 1, suspected stage 2 is definitive, stage 3 it's advanced. This stage actually, or this is criteria or Bell staging criteria. The Walsh, he did it actually to uniform the diagnosis across the centers. It will be homogeneity in the center or uniformities of the diagnosis across the center. It will decrease the heterogeneity between the center in diagnosis or classified the necrotizing enterocolitis. And the most important issue in this criteria, actual Bell staging, is not continuum. What is the meaning of not continuum? This means the baby may present with advanced neck without earlier sign or symptoms. It can present from stage 3 from the start. No, actually is not to go chronologically with stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. It can present with perforation from the start without any clinical sign or symptoms. So this is Bell staging is not continuum, not continuum. And like continuum, continue from continuity. From continuity. So stage 1, what is this stage 1? Clinical sign and symptoms. What is the clinical sign of symptoms? This is GI symptom and extra GI symptom. GI symptom like abdominal distension, bilious vomiting, gastric aspirate, constipation, bowel nest open. This is GI. Extra GI, systemic manifestation. This is temperature instability like sepsis, like Big Short, temperature instability, apneic, DSAD, BRAD. There is even the biochemical is goes with systemic manifestations, thrombocytopenia, hyponatremia, metabolic acidosis. This is clinical sign and symptoms. This is what is the meaning of clinical sign and symptom. GI symptom and extra GI, and extra GI it will be cardiovascular and even the laboratory it goes in the systemic sign of the necrotizing anterior colitis. The most important is abdominal sign. Abdominal sign and non-diagnostic radiography. Stage 1 actually is vague, non-specific. Abnormal distribution of gas, dilated bowels, is no clear pneumatosis intestinalis, and non-specific signs. Non-specific, we call it suspected neck. We call it suspected neck. This is stage 1. Stage 2, same clinical sign and symptoms. But the most important issue here, the X-ray finding pneumatosis intestinalis or intramural gas or portal venous gases on the X-ray. But this is stage 2 should be actually these two classification A and P based on what? The clinical condition of the baby. Stage 2 A, call it mild ill patients. Stage 2 P, call it moderately ill with systemic toxicity. Stage 3, this is advanced. This is clinical sign and symptom also, but the pneumatosis and cyanitis also, and the baby critically ill, and A, impending intestinal perforation and proven intestinal perforation. So how to differentiate between the three stages in one word? By radiology. Because the sign, clinical sign and symptoms will be same, all radiological finding, it will give you clue. This is stage 1 or 2 or 3. Stage 1, non-specific, it's called it alias. نون سبيسيفيك دايليتد باول ثيك باول ابنورمال جاز ديستريبيوشن سو ذيس از ستيج 1 سسبكتد نيك ستيج 2 نيماتوزيس انتستينالز انتراميورال جاز بابل جاز بابل ات ويل بي ذير از بابل ستيج 3 بيرفوريشن So this is what is the outline management of this case? It's 5N. 5N. Any baby you suspected there is suspected neck or definitive neck or perforation, there is call it 5N. Outline 5N. You have to keep this patient NBO, nothing per mouse, NGT free drainage, just to decompress the stomach, to ventilate the stomach, just to remove the to decrease the secretion in the stomach, just so to help the respiratory the abdominal distension, it will compromise the respiration. So if you release this gases and you release this content of the stomach, so it will help for improving the respiratory function. So you have to keep this patient NBO. And the second issue is you have to put NGT free drainage, a large replogue tubes just to ventilate the stomach, to decompress the stomach, to not compromise the respiration. The third one, normal saline resuscitation, fluid resuscitation. These babies actually need more fluids because the third space need more fluid and need TPN. So normal saline or fluid resuscitation and TPN. And the fourth N, you have to notify the surgeon. When to notify the surgeon? In second stage, just to inform him we have baby second stage, maybe he will call you at any time if there is any impending perforations, just to notify him. But stage three, you have to tell him come immediately, this is surgical emergency. And the fifth in non-specific radiological finding, any non-specific radiological finding and you suspected neck, you have to take septocore cup and start an antibiotic. This is for non-specific radiological finding. You have to take septic hookup and start antibiotic. If this is stage 3, you have to add metronidazole or clindamycin. The antibiotic was started ampicillin gentamicin. This is the outline management, simply actually. NBO, NGT free drainage, normal saline fluid resuscitation, notify the surgeon or surgical consultation, and if non-specific radiology, you have to take septic work up, started antibiotic. This is the line of management based on the stages. Stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 1 suspected, stage 2 definitive, stage 3 it's called advanced neck. Stage 1 diagnosis clinically and biochemically and radiologically. How to diagnose clinically is non-specific in stage 1 based on the clinical sign and symptoms and radiological finding. Radiological finding is non-specific. It's called like ileus, baritic ileus, septic ileus or whatever. But what is your management in the stage 1 necrotizing enterocolitis? NBO, NGT free drainage, normal saline and fluid resuscitations, notify the surgeon and take septic work up, start antibiotic, and you can take the septic work up and take CBC electrolytes, and based on the CBC and electrolyte you can adjust the fluid and correct the metabolic derangement, or if there is hyponatremia or electrolyte disturbance, you have to correct it. For sure you have to start antibiotic ampicillin gentamicin. Only for how long? Should keep this patient NBO 48 hours and antibiotic 48 hours only. NBO 48 hours, antibiotic for 48 hours until to see what is going on. Stage 2, also how to diagnose this? Clinically, biochemically, radiologically. Clinically, is there is clinical sign and symptoms, and radiologically by pneumatosis intestinalis and portal gases. And stage 1 or 2 depend on the clinical situation. Mildly ill will be A and moderately ill it will be B. What is the management? I will keep NBO, NGT free drainage, normal saline resuscitation fluid management and TPN, and you have to notify the surgeon and septic take non-specific. There is specific now, specific radiological finding. You have to take septic work up, start antibiotic. For how long will continue the actually will continue the antibiotic ampicillin and gentamicin? It will be 14 days. Sometimes the people prefer to start clindamycin and surgical consultation. For sure, you have to do surgical consultation. And the X-ray at that time, you can do it 8 to 12 hourly because there is impending, to looking for impending intestinal perforation. Stage 3, same. How to diagnose this? Clinically, biochemically, radiologically. Clinically, there is clinical sign and symptoms, and radiologically, it will be impending perforation or pneumoperitoneum or gas under the diaphragm or gas above the liver. So, and the baby clinically, it will be clinically critically ill. It will be critically ill. What is the management of this patient? You have to keep NPO, NGT drainage, NG free drainage, and normal saline fluid resuscitation and fluid resuscitation and TPN, and the 4 actually it will not notify the surgeon. You have to call the surgeon immediately, come immediately. This is surgical emergency. You have to intervene based on the clinical situation of the patient. Patient is stable, so you can laparotomy. If the patient unstable, less than 1 kilo, so this need been roost drain. You have to drain this air. You have to drain this air. This is the management. For how long I will continue antibiotic? The antibiotic you have to continue for 14 days. You have to add metronidazole or clindamycin. You have to add metronidazole or clindamycin. For stage 1, just ampicillin gentamicin. Stage 2, it will be ampicillin gentamicin. If you would like to add clinda, this, if you afraid there is impending perforation, you can. But it's okay, you can continue ampicillin gentamicin. For stage 3, for sure, you have to add clindamycin or metronidazole for anaerobic coverage. At the end, I would like to pray for my colleagues is going for exam, Saudi board, Jordanian board, Arab board, and my colleagues in UNITAR fellowship. Ask Allah رب العرش العظيم أن ينجح كل زملائنا يا رب وأن يرفع عنا البلاء والكرب إن شاء الله وفيروس الكورونا يا رب. شكرا, سلام عليكم.